What's going on? We're live in New York City. This is the Build Series. I'm Kevin Kenny. And our guest today has been gracing the cover of magazines, staying quite busy at New York Fashion Week, and has a brand new single out we're excited to chat with her about. Please let's make some noise for Julie Mintz. How are you, Julie?
Good, how are you?
I'm great. This is a really cool full circle moment because if you don't know at home, you performed this song live for us here about 5 months ago. So for you to come back and now talk about it being out and available for us to stream and buy is just really cool.
Yes, it's so crazy because last time we were here, we just, as a treat for the audience, Moby was like, let's do some extra songs. And we had never performed Purple Rain, Million Reasons.
That was the first time.
Yes, and I was so annoyed with him because he was like, let's just do that song. And I'm like, no, I don't know if you remember, I had my cell phone with the lyrics on the phone just to make sure I got them right. And then because we did it here, he was like, I think maybe we should consider recording that.
Yeah. Classic Moby, right? Because he's always challenging you. I feel like that's how it works, your guys' dynamic, is he puts you in these uncomfortable situations, but you always come out better for it.
He's been like my biggest challenger and my biggest supporter, and I feel like that's been really great for me. Like, I can be such a perfectionist and really want to like redo every take and labor over everything, and he's like, no, one take, like, that's not what people care about. They really care about the emotion, and they don't care if every note's in tune. And so, yeah, like when I was here performing, I would never have, in front of a live audience, done a song that I'd never rehearsed. But he's been doing it for 25 years. So he's like, people will love that if you do a song that you've never rehearsed. That's exciting. And you know, also for me personally, for anyone, if you do something that you've never tried before and it goes okay, you feel good about yourself.
Oh, yeah.
So that was like a good experience to do it for the audience.
And such a cool human moment, right?
Because
I think that's what we crave from music, from art, right, is vulnerability and relatability. And, you know, you were up there and you took a chance and it paid off and it was really cool. He had a great quote, actually, that I never heard before, but speaking to that, we want imperfection in music and art. I think Moby said something to the effect of, you know, you want your car to be perfect. You want a plane you're in to be perfect. You don't want music to be perfect. And I think it's so true.
It's so true. I feel like that's probably, making music has been, it's really like a spiritual lesson for me, because that's something that I've really struggled with. And all of the themes that I write about are really like emotional struggles that I'm having. So that's like what I'm learning through the things that I'm writing about, struggling with overcoming perfectionism and knowing that that's really what connects with people is our flaws and our imperfections. And, you know, even the other themes that I write about, loneliness, heartbreak, longing, I feel like those are things that everyone has, but we kind of tend to hide and put up a brave face. But that's what comes out in my art.
Yeah, and it's so funny because we all do that, and we're really doing each other such a disservice, right? Because leaning into those things is what brings us all together.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. When did you start using music as an outlet to, you know, explore those ideas? You know, not just talking about the record that you put out earlier this year, but, you know, just as a creative, because you are involved with so many different art forms. One was music, something you got involved with.
I mean, growing up as a kid, I sang in choir and I played piano, but I was, you know, playing classical pieces that I was learning. Although I was always really into the blues.
Okay.
I recently was home at my parents' house. Remember the old piano benches?
Yeah.
That you would lift up? All of my old piano books were in there, and it was like beginner blues for kids. So I was always like, I guess, really drawn to that kind of like sad, heartfelt music.
Yeah.
But I was obviously not writing my own songs. It wasn't, I'd say, until my really early 20s when I moved away from home and I was living in Los Angeles by myself, and I had a little keyboard in my bedroom, and that's, I think, when I really, you know, started experiencing a lot of those feelings of longing that I started writing those songs.
That's awesome. I mean, we're kind of being funny here because you have been on the show before, but we're assuming that everyone was there watching. Let's talk about your upbringing just a little bit. You're from Texas, and you had, I love this story, so I got to bring it up, but you were the high school cheerleader that also worked at the funeral home?
Yes. Okay. So I'm from Corpus Christi, Texas. It's a small town on the Gulf Coast. And my high school job, I worked in a funeral home and cemetery. But being from Texas, obviously, like, it's gospel, football and cheerleading. And so I would always have to rush from cheerleading practice to work. And so they would let me come in my cheerleading uniform to work. And one of my jobs was to drive a hearse. And so sometimes I was like in my little red and white cheerleading uniform driving the hearse.
If only there were camera phones back then. We had visuals of that, you know?
Oh my God, that's so true. I know, I don't have any pictures of that.
Such a great picture.
Yeah.
Album cover right there. I got to ask though, you know, I feel like so many kids in high school, that they would be scared away from a job like that. Why did you not mind working at a funeral home?
No, I'd minded.
Oh, you did?
I was terrified. So my family owned the funeral home.
Oh, right on.
So everyone in my family had to work there. My brothers actually had to dig graves like in the Texas heat. So I was actually really lucky that I got to like drive in the air-conditioned hearse. And I was really scared. Like, I mean, I'm a total scaredy cat. I'm still scared of the dark to this day. And the bathrooms were down the same hallway as the embalming rooms. And so I was always terrified. Like, I feel like I would, if I had to pee, I would like hold it till the last minute.
It's such a unique experience at such a young age and also just a unique relationship to life and death. Do you ever find that informs your art even to this day?
I bring it up because I do think that really influenced me, just thinking every day, being around that every day. And it really got me thinking a lot about death. And one of the first songs that I wrote for my last album is called Lavender Lips. And the chorus is, "Will you kiss my lavender lips when I die?" And it's all about leaving, how we leave the world alone. And I feel like I really experienced that firsthand by working there every day.
Does it, because I think two things can happen. Being around death like that, it can depress you, or it can actually liberate you and make you really appreciate the present. Did you find you gravitate towards one of those?
I feel like because I was so young, it actually probably, I did find it a little depressing because I think it's just hard to process when you're that age. But as I got older, I think because making music for me is so, like my creativity is so tied to like, my spiritual seeking in life. And so something that I did a few years ago while I was writing my album, I did a course called Year to Live. And so you spend an entire year of your life as if it's your last year to live. And you literally start with 365 days and you have like a countdown, and I kept a journal every day. And you have like a lot of assignments. I wrote letters to everyone important in my life, saying what they mean to me. So it's kind of like you get your life in order as if you are going to leave the earth in a year. But then the amazing thing is hopefully you get to keep going on living.
What a cool idea.
Yeah. And so that actually really propelled me to finish my album at that time, because I was like, okay, if I really only had a year to live, what are all of the things that I would do? So I feel like I had a different appreciation for death as I matured.
Right. I want to get into your relationship with Moby really quick, because you were stopped by with him last time you were on Build, and you've been described as like a muse for Moby. You guys are collaborators, though, on music and various things. He directed the video we'll show in a little bit. How did you meet? You met because his buddy like parked in your driveway? Is this the story?
Yeah, so I lived in a little rental house in Beechwood Canyon in LA, and it was in the shadow of this amazing huge castle that sat empty for a lot of years. And I heard that Moby had bought it, but I had never met him. And then one day a guy was parking in my driveway, and he was like, "Oh my God, I'm so sorry. I'm trying to go to a housewarming party at your new neighbor's house." And he's like, "If you let me park here, you can come to the party with me." And I'm like, "You know, it's okay. I don't want to go to a stranger's party." But he was insistent. Like, he was like, "Just come for 5 minutes." So I would have let him park there anyways. But but so I went to the party with him. And that's how I first met Moby. And he was so friendly. Like, I was a little bit intimidated. Plus, I was like crashing my neighbor's party that I wasn't invited to. But he was like, "Oh, you're my neighbor. Let's exchange emails." And he emailed me the next day and was like, "Hey, would you like to come over for tea?" And he knew that I was a singer-songwriter. And I think the first time I came over for tea, he was like, he had a guitar right there. He was like, "Play me something you're working on." I mean, I think my hands were shaking.
I was going to say, how nervous must you have been?
Yeah, I was really, really nervous. And so he would like give me advice on songwriting, but we really just became friendly. It was just nice to have somebody across the street to hang out with. And then a few months into our friendship, he sent me an email that was like, I'm going to be playing my new single on The Tonight Show. Can you sing backup for me? And I had to read the email about five times before I realized that he was asking. I swear to God, I thought he was asking if I knew someone that could sing backup for him. So, but I played it cool. Yeah. I was like, yeah, of course.
It's crazy. And like, we're here today. So present day, you guys collaborated on Purple Rain, Million Reasons. Did Moby produce this at all? Did he have a hand in that?
Yes, it was 100% Moby. So after we performed it here, so initially, I guess we had already figured it out. So we had been playing Purple Rain a bunch.
Like at parties, right? Weren't you busting it out, like with friends?
And Moby is so philanthropic, so he does tons of charity shows. And so anytime we're in LA, if we play a charity show, he likes to add covers to the set. So he was like, do Purple Rain as a cover. So we had been doing that for a while. So he was like, I think we should do a really pretty sort of like melancholic, a little bit of your country style cover of Purple Rain. So, and he has a studio in his home, which is really nice. So it's easy. It's just the two of us, no pressure. So he's like, let's come over. Let's just see if we like how Purple Rain turns out. So we were in his studio and I was just playing Purple Rain on his piano, kind of figuring out if I wanted to change the key and see how I wanted to do it. And it was around the time that A Star Is Born had come out. And so, and I was kind of late to discovering Lady Gaga, but after I saw that movie, I was so into her. So I'd been listening to the Joanne album a bunch. So as I was playing Purple Rain, I was like, I think this is a similar chord progression. I just heard Million Reasons. So I sang Purple Rain, and then I just started singing Million Reasons, and it worked, the same chords worked. And he was like, well, I actually thought he was going to be like, what is that? Because he doesn't like a lot of current pop music necessarily. But I thought he was going to say, what is that in like a negative way? But he was like, what is that? That sounds really good. And I was like, oh, it's a Lady Gaga song. He was like, that's cool. Let's do it together. So that's literally how the mashup idea came about. Like
super organically. And then do we have that clip? Can we roll that again that we did at the top of the show? This is the, I want to call this for, I think, it's called like a short film, right? It's more than a music video, right? It's like a film clip.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, it is the music video, but Moby just had this idea to try to just make it very cinematic and beautiful.
Gotcha.
And yeah, just we shot it in his backyard in LA.
That's really cool. So, I mean, how did you collaborate on music, but how do you collaborate on this? Like, does Moby like map it out? Is it more just like...
No, he's so organic. This was like, I think this came about because we wanted to go to dinner on a Sunday night. So okay. He's like, okay, well, if we want to go to dinner at 7, then why don't you come over at 6 when the light's really pretty? And we'll shoot it, and then we can go to dinner.
Wow, really? Yeah. That's like pre-dinner right there.
Yep.
That's amazing.
That's how he works. So.
Well, let's talk about the other side of things these days is fashion. You've been so busy this week at New York Fashion Week. I don't know a thing about fashion, but it looks so much fun. But it also looks exhausting. It's a lot of work going on all these shows, huh?
I wouldn't say it's work, but it is exhausting. But it's really fun. I mean, I grew up loving fashion. My mom was a beauty queen. So even though I was from like a tiny town, and I'm from Texas, so you can imagine like my mom would like do her hair big and wear, this is the 80s, so she'd wear like jumpsuits with like shoulder pads and rhinestones just to pick me up from school in my small town. So I feel like I've always had a love of fashion. So to be invited to go to shows at New York Fashion Week is so fun for me. And I mean, I don't know how, I feel like everybody has a different way of doing it. For me, I'm not like fancy. I don't have a stylist, but I'm really into it. So I want to wear something to each show that I feel like complements what the designer is showing. And I'm super organized and OCD. So I like plan everything ahead of time. I like research, you know, sort of what the style of the designer is going to be, try to plan an outfit that I think will, you know, it's like a costume party.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's fun to go to a costume party when you feel like you're dressed right. So I have this just very systematic way of that I pack everything, chronologically in my suitcase. It's really, it's kind of a beautiful mind if you look in my suitcase.
Is the prep almost as fun as the actual shows you get to go to?
No, the prep is kind of insanely psycho, but okay. It's just the way that I have to do it. Okay. But then when I get here, it's like done. Like I literally just take a bag out of my suitcase. It's already like on the hanger and I'm just like, okay, I'm wearing that day one, I'm wearing that day two. And then I just go.
Yeah. What's been your favorite things you've seen? Maybe it's a show, maybe it's a couple different trends you've spotted while in town.
We went one night to a show. The designer is called Chromat, and it's a swimwear line, but it's really body positive. So they had like all different kinds of models. So they had plus size models. They had trans women. They had one woman walking who's an amputee. And it was just so inspiring. I think especially like seeing other shows, you're seeing a lot of really thin, beautiful models. And then I just feel like every day when we're looking at pictures on Instagram, you know, you see, I think we forget that people are so like filtered and airbrushed. And so to see girls walking down the runway with cellulite and like jiggling and stuff, I felt so good when I left that show. I'm like, that's what women are supposed to look like, and we don't have to walk around all the time like sucking in and like worrying if we have cellulite.
Right.
So that was really inspiring. And then I went to another show last night and Dr. Ruth was there.
And she was just at Build.
What?
She was on the exchange rate like a couple weeks ago. Yeah, she was a guest here.
I didn't know that she was still working.
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, I just love, I just watched her documentary and I just think she's incredible. She's a Holocaust survivor.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and so I mean, I know that's not really like very fashion-y, but I was like, I think it's cool that Dr. Ruth is at a fashion show.
That's amazing. Yeah. What show was it? Do you remember?
It was Hogan McLaughlin.
Okay, cool.
And his stuff is really beautiful. It's very gothic. Kind of feels like, it like almost feels like you'd be like in a cape in like a haunted forest or something, like hoods and like long gowns and stuff.
That's awesome. It
didn't really seem like Dr. Ruth's style.
Hey.
But she seemed excited to be there.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
And then I want to talk before we hand it over to the audience. You are on the cover. Is it the September issue of Retreat magazine?
Yes.
This is so cool. So something like I've obviously never done, probably never will do. How does that work? Where like in terms of the creative, do you collaborate with the photographers? Is there like a vision? Like take me inside being on the cover of a magazine.
I know that was so fun. It's like all the fun parts of doing music again, like you get to like dress up but not really the scary parts of performing and being super vulnerable. You know, it's just like a fun day of playing pretend. And for that, again, we did our own styling just because I kind of know what I like. And there's with some really nice designers that loaned us clothes, Badgley Mischka. I'm going to see their show tomorrow. They make really beautiful gowns. So, you know, people just loan you clothes. And we did it at a hotel in Los Angeles with a really beautiful pool. And it's just like a fun day where people pamper you.
Yeah, it came out fantastic. You can check it out online. Let's get to the first of two fan questions. It'll come from over here.
Hi, thanks for coming to talk to us today. I just wanted to ask what your like favorite musical influences are currently and also like from the past, because I'm always interested in that.
Yeah. Currently, I love Lana Del Rey. And she's just such a talented poet. And I've only listened to her new album once all the way through. I feel like I need to give it another good listen, but hope is a dangerous thing for a woman like me to have. I know, it's so incredible. I wish you could see the audience. So incredible. And, you know, I play Americana music, so I'm really into that world as well. I love Brandi Carlile. I think she's so talented. And like Maren Morris, Kacey Musgraves, all those women that are doing that sort of country feel. Yeah. Speaking of Brandi Carlile, she's playing Joni Mitchell's entire Blue album in LA next month, which I really want to see. And that kind of brings me to my past influences. Joni Mitchell's like my ultimate number one. But then also growing up in Texas, I listened mostly to classic country growing up. So like Dolly Parton, June Carter Cash, nice. All those classic country women. And then also like 80s and 90s country. Shania Twain, Faith Hill.
Totally. Awesome.
Thank you.
That's a great question. Let's get to one more. It'll come from right over here.
Hello. I just wanted to say I love your outfit.
Thank you.
I was wondering who you're wearing.
Thank you. I'm so glad you asked me about it because I love it too. It's actually all vintage. This is from this online store that I found on Instagram called Desert Vintage. And I got these shoes at this vintage store in Colorado called Kimo Sabe. And they make them from vintage cowboy boots. They like cut them off.
Oh, wow.
I know. Cool. Aren't they so fun? And then I just put a leotard under my little dress.
Do you like that when they sort of reimagine or repurpose vintage clothing to make like a new item?
I do. I mean, cool, right? But I mean, I also love just really authentic vintage things that are untouched too. Yeah. I feel like sometimes that's the best, even like, I'm not playing for y'all today, but my guitar that I'm playing right now is a 1967 Guild.
Oh, wow.
And like the thing that's amazing about it, it was really hard to find because it hasn't been touched in any way. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's really hard to find them having been around for that long without somebody like changing something about it.
Yeah. That's awesome. The boots almost remind me of what you've done with the, you know, a classic. You've reimagined a vintage, you know, body of work.
I love that.
Well, where can we find you online or on social media, I should say, before we go here?
I'm everywhere as Julie Mintz. I like Instagram. I like the visual stuff on there.
Totally.
A little bit on Twitter. And then my single, Purple Rain, Million Reasons, is on Spotify and iTunes and everywhere you stream music.
Awesome. Guys, one more time for Julie Mintz.
Thank you.